Hey, it is First Chapter Fridays. Today, I will be reading from Devils Within by S.F. Henson. This is considered a realistic fiction book, but it starts with this novel is inspired by true events. If he catches me, I'm dead, literally dead, like the trees I'm racing past, like mom, like no longer a part of this evil freaking world. So I run. I'm tempted to stop, to give up, and let him kill me, because when it comes down to it, death might be a relief, since it's the only way I'll ever be free. Nathaniel, his scream echoes through the dark woods, seeming to come from everywhere at once. It rattles my bones, chilling me to the core, shaking my instinct for self-preservation loose. I'm not ready to die yet, not by his hand, not while he's still alive. I kick it into another gear. Spindly brush scratches my arms like sharp fingernails. My lungs burn with cold. Snowflakes sting my cheeks. The snow falls so fast and thick. He's nothing but a blur when I glance over my shoulder. Then I'm on the ground. Wet snow seeping through the knees of my jeans. My boot is tangled in a tree root. The red laces are streaks of blood against the snow. Nathaniel, he bellows again, closer, much closer. I struggle against the root, clawing at my laces. I have to get the boot off, have to get free. I didn't mean it earlier. I want to live. I want to live. My boot slides off and I scramble up the embankment, trying to ignore the freezing water creeping up my sock. A crushing weight tackles me from behind and I'm buried in the snow again. He's on top of me. He rolls me onto my back, pinning my arms at my sides and his knees. His fist slams into my wind-burned cheek and bombs explode in my skull. His gun is in his hand. The butt sails through the air towards my temple. This is it. This is where I die. I squeeze my eyes shut. No, I can't die like this. I have to do something. Stop him from Nate. My eyes fly open. I raise my fist, ready to fight him off. Long brown hair grazes my shoulder, tickling my neck. Nate, are you okay? I blink a couple of times, forcing myself to focus. Miss Erica, my social worker, leans over me, brows furrowed, eyes scrunched in concern. I'm not in the woods. My fingers curl around the navy button hanging from the string around my neck. I'm in the office of the West Kentucky Psychiatric Center. I repeat it over and over in my head. He's not after me, not anymore, and not ever again. Do I need to get Dr. Sterling? Miss Erica asks. I'm fine, I say. You sure? I nod once. Did you take your meds this morning? Of course not. The little pills make me fuzzy, like my brain is lined with cotton that's been teased apart. I haven't decided which is better. Always fuzzy or so sharp, a crack or a shout or a blast of cold air rockets me back to that night in the woods. My free fingers trace 587 on the arm of the chair in an endless loop. You have to take the meds if you're ever going to have a normal life, Miss Erica says. I snort. There aren't enough drugs in the world for that to happen. Fine. A chance at a normal life. I'm not certain what normal even looks like. It sure as hell isn't anything I've ever known, and it's not like the stuff they show on sitcoms at night in the common area. No one is that happy. Real problems aren't comical, they're deadly. Miss Erica straightens out her short green skirt, then smooths the hand over it. I'll call Stanley and have him bring your meds. No. I catch her slim wrist before she can leave. I can't be fuzzy today. I'll take them when I'm out. Promise, just not today. Her glance shifts to the window and her brow furrows. All right, she sighs, but only for today. No breaks when you're out. Deal. She pats my hand and I realize I'm still clinging to her wrist. Life is going to be weird without her. Miss Erica and I have worked together since the beginning. She was my first social worker and I was her first client. What an introduction to social work. A demented 15-year-old with fresh blood on his hands. Are you ready to go? She asks. I can't possibly be ready. I've been in the psych center since it happened, except for the 3 weeks in the farmer jail and a month stint in juvie before my lawyer sprang me. A year and a half since, and I've been a part of the outside world. Although I guess I never really had been a part of it. Not the one Miss Erica knows. I only known two versions of the world, and they both sucked. I don't remember my first 2 years other than flashes here and there. A wood-paneled room, mom in a blue dress, his arm around her, tufts of grass dotting a big backyard, a white dog with brown spots rolling in the dirt, rusty red splotches streaked down the white porcelain sink in the tiny bathroom, bruises on my arms, angry welts on my legs. The first clear memory I have, the first actual moment, is so tainted with fear, I can't be sure I can recall it accurately. I was 5. Mom and I were on the run and had stopped me at a grocery store for bread. Her hand tightened around mine and the loaf slipped into the floor with a soft thump and a crinkle of plastic. A big, bald man in a green jacket stood in front of us, a tattoo etched in his neck in hard, angry lines. I'd seen that mark before, back at the fort, but I didn't know what it was. I do now, all too well. Mom hurried down the aisle and around the corner, looking back every few steps. As soon as we reached the sliding glass door, she scooped me up and broke into a run. Her nails dug into my skin and I cried out, which only made her squeeze harder. We raced down the street to the motel, to our room at the back, the one with the busted lock. Mom shoved me in the closet, someone pounded on the outside door, and a hot trickle worked down my leg. A sour smell followed, but I didn't move. I stayed crouched in the hot, stuffy closet for I don't know how long. Hours, probably. Just like every other time it happened. Every time she'd see someone with that tattoo or one of the white and black patches on their jackets, the ones that said skinhead. That was my world for 4 years, flitting from town to town, not telling anyone our real names. Then she died, not from one of them, but from a random gas station robbery. Wrong place, wrong time. She died, and my world smashed together like lumps of old Play-Doh, all cracked and crumbly and ugly. The judge sent me back to the fort, to him, to daily mantras and indoctrinations, combat boots in my ribs and fists in my face until the day it happened. The psych center is the only safety I'd ever known. What I really want is to stay here and be different forever, not to leave with some stranger. Miss Erica sits on the hard plastic chair beside me, grounding me into the present as much as my button. You can do this, Nate. You have this under control as long as you take the meds. That's the problem. If I were insane, it would be easy. They'd keep me here. They'd keep me here safe, unable to hurt anyone else. I should have pretended to be worse than I am. What if it happens again? I say, running my button along its string. What if I snap? I got off on self-defense once. Mentally unstable, my lawyer said. Once they release me, once I'm declared officially sane, that's it. I lose myself and it's jail. You'll be fine, Miss Erica says. I still don't see why I can't stay. She covers my hand with hers. The judge required 9 months. That's up today. Dr. Sterling says you're cleared, so it's time to move into the next phase of treatment. Besides, you don't want to spend your life cooped up in this place. I gave her my most pleading look. She smiled. You'll have a brand new social worker to torment now. I don't want another social worker. I want you. Miss Erica knows me and who I am deep down inside, and she doesn't judge me for it. Only 3 people in my life have truly cared about me. Mom, Kelsey, my only friend at the fort, and Miss Erica. All 3 have been torn away from me. Trust me, Nate, if I could stay on with you, I would, but I can't follow you across the country. It's only 2 states. You know, it doesn't work like that. I'm sure you and your new caseworker will get along fine. Just give her a chance. Don't forget how far you've come. Keep moving forward. I stifle the scoff working up in my throat. I'm a snake eating its tail. Every time I try to move forward, I end up worse than when I started. You won't be alone again, she says, although she already knows the comeback ready on my tongue. You'll have your uncle. Right. The uncle I didn't know existed until a few weeks ago. I have vague memories of Mom making tear-filled phone calls from the hotel rooms, pleading for an answer, then slamming the receiver in their cradle, saying, that stinking traitor was no help to anyone. She never talked about a brother, never talked about anyone, but that must have been who she met. I know she wouldn't have been calling the fort. And now I know there was someone out there, an uncle, who could have helped us, one who never came forward, not when she died, not when he told the judge Mom had kidnapped me, not when the judge sent me back to the fort. Not until my social worker tracked him down and somehow convinced him to take me in. Miss Erica tucked her hair behind one ear. Are you sure you don't want to tell your... I'm sure. I'm not about to let her blab the details of my life to some man I've never met. If he cared enough to want to know about me, he would have picked up the phone years ago. Dr. Sterling and Miss Erica are the only ones who know the things I've done, and I actually didn't tell them. I wrote it down during our sessions. It's all too horrible to say out loud. Okay, Miss Erica says, your choice, but I hope you'll change your mind. The heavy wooden office door creaks open. A short, slim man pokes his head in and glances around. His eyes slide past me like butter on hot toast and settle on Miss Erica. Their mom's eyes, dark and deep set. He has her nose too, thin and narrow, same high cheekbones. All I have of Mom is the navy button around my neck from her one good shirt and the images in my mind, blurry memories wearing at the edges like battered photographs. This man throws them back in sharp contrast, this man who abandoned us. How dare he look like her? A darkness crawls through my veins that I've been trying to figure out how to destroy since I arrived here. Before then, really. It's always been there, a low heat in my gut that has to be smothered before it morphs into a full-on geyser. That's when I hurt people. Truth is, sometimes you have to hurt people to survive. Look weak and you might as well be dead. You sure will wish you were. I wasn't always this way, or maybe I was and the beatings drew it out. This dark beast dwelling under my skin. And then the more I let it out, the harder it became to keep it caged. The beast prowls in my blood, his blood, restless, waiting for a reason to show itself, like now. I see myself getting up, running at the man, slamming his head into the thick door. I hear the sound it makes, a squelchy thunks, as if I hit a watermelon with a mallet. Instead, I close my eyes, breathe deep, and picture a clear night sky. Focus on a part far away, a single dot of light. I usually picture it getting closer and closer until it becomes a planet, until it swallows me and the darkness and there's nothing but light. Sometimes it doesn't work, though. Sometimes the dark is too great. It nibbles at the edge of the pool light, refusing to allow it any closer. Sometimes I'm afraid the darkness will swallow me instead. Mr. Clements, Miss Erica says, I'm Erica Tufts. Follow me. There's still some final paperwork to fill out.